Hello, and welcome to the Eldridge Collection. My name is Aaron Peterson, the curator. Today we're going to talk about the 2022 reimagining of Hellraiser. It was directed by David Bruckner and stars a cast of fairly new actors, including Odessa A'zion, I believe is how you pronounce it, as the main actress, the main character, Drew Starkey, and Jamie Clayton as Pinhead, or as she's credited, the priest. Here's the logline. A take on Clive Barker's 1987 horror classic, where a young woman struggling with addiction comes into possession of an ancient puzzle box, unaware that its purpose is to summon the Cenobites. Now, to be honest, this is my first viewing of a Hellraiser film. I watched a YouTube video that explained the ending of the first Hellraiser, and I assume there are other sequels, but I haven't gotten around to watching them. This one I wanted to check out, I think primarily because of the updated graphics. I thought it might have been better and a little less sort of early 90s, 80s campy gore. The general idea of this film is that there is this puzzle box that summons these demons called Cenobites, and it was brought to the country by an eccentric art collector who deals primarily in occult items. The idea of the demonic puzzle box, the occult art collector, all of those themes and possible visual motifs obviously drew me in, you know, given this channel and what you might know about me. The execution of the film was a little bit lacking. But let me start off with a couple things that I actually like about the movie. And for one, the production design. I thought they had some really good set pieces. They had some really interesting makeup and special effects. They put a lot of attention into the actual puzzle box itself, which, you know, made me interested. I was always curious about how it changed and how it morphed, and I started trying to solve the puzzle along with the characters. Also really like the mansion that you see at the beginning and the end of the film. I think it was very creepy, but also very grand and mysterious. I liked that setting that they created. In addition to the production design, I also appreciated, you know, I'll say I appreciated the acting. I think everybody did a really good job with the material that they were given. I thought the main character was believable, sincere. I thought that the characters playing the Cenobites were all very creepy and brooding and moved in interesting and unique ways. And that might have more to do with the special effects. You know, no one stood out as particularly stiff or awkward or unwatchable. So, what I liked. The production design and the actors were okay. So let's go into what I didn't like about this film. And for one, it was the atmosphere. The whole film felt very matter-of-fact in the worst way. There was no mystery, there was no dread, there was no pull to care about the main characters or even to care about the bad guys. It was basically the story of a genie mixed with horrific BDSM gore. And that matter-of-fact delivery of the situation that they were in and the peril that they were in made it lose all tension. So, you know, you knew most of the characters were going to die, and you knew pretty quickly exactly how they were all going to die, and they didn't vary from that approach very often. The Cenobites are kind of one-trick ponies. The ending twist, if you could call it that, was, has been done several times. And at that point in the film, they were all surrounded by Cenobites. They were all doomed to a lesser certain extent. And the twist didn't add anything to the tension or into the reveal, and it all kind of played out the way you'd expect it to. So that was disappointing for sure. Also, the gore, I mean, the production design, the design of the creatures of the Cenobites, I thought was interesting and imaginative, and I appreciate, you know, some of the different creatures and different effects that they were able to, you know, employ on the actual Cenobite design. but the gore itself felt either gratuitous or anticlimactic, I guess. And it wasn't scary, it was just gross to be gross. You want to go to a movie like this, or at least I want to go to a movie like this, for the dread, for the suspense, for the mystery, for the questions left unanswered. And what I got instead was basically torture porn. It was just enough story to get from one centibyte kill to another centibyte kill to another centibyte kill. And if that's what you're into, if that's what you want out of a Hellraiser movie, then I think it succeeds. But I was left wanting a lot more, especially since the you know, behind all of that mediocrity and gross gore, there were concepts there that would have been really fascinating to explore, like how a Cenobite is created, what their god is, what, you know, what the character's relationship with lust and pain and addiction actually is. There were all these themes that were stated, but they were never explored. And it was a bit disappointing, to be sure. I also want to touch on the cinematography a little bit, because I don't know what it is, but it seems like most straight-to-streaming movies look the exact same, and it's starting to drive me a little bit crazy. Like, do you remember straight-to-TV movies? And, you know, sort of like old TV fantasy shows like Hercules and Xena and the straight-to-TV Salem's Lot by Stephen King. Like, they all kind of look the same, and I'm sure part of that is just budget, where they all probably had the same studio film cameras that shot the same studio film stock as the sitcoms and other, you know, shows that that network was putting on. But now, with streaming services, like, they're countrywide or worldwide, there's hundreds of different cameras, there's hundreds of different editing techniques and color correcting techniques, and they all look the same. They have this, you know, they're really dark, for one. They use red and blue a lot. They also, you know, do the blue and teal thing, like everyone else does, but it's that sort of, like, bubblegum pop. Like, soup, like, too clean look, the Netflix look. And, you know, this is a film that came out on Hulu, but it still looks the same as Stranger Things and The Witcher and all the other sort of straight-to-streaming films. And that's kind of a bummer. Like, that was a missed opportunity here as well, especially since it's a reimagining of an older cult classic horror film. You know, they could have brought in different film stocks or emulated different film stocks. They could have taken their time with different shots. They could have done something, you know? I guess that's why I'm ragging on this one so much, is because having not seen the original, I wanted this one to be better, which is not something I find myself saying about any other remake or reimagining when I've seen the original, so I shouldn't have had too much faith. But then again, at the same time, I'm not really in a hurry to see the original Hellraiser either. Comment below and let me know if you think it's worth me checking out either the original Hellraiser or one of the sequels. I also want to talk about the directing a little bit as well. It was directed by David Bruckner, and he's done a couple other horror films that you might be familiar with, VHS and The Ritual. I've seen The Ritual most recently, and that was a movie that I actually particularly liked. I really cared about the four characters, the four main characters. There's a good balance of humor and character development, and when the horror escalated towards the end of the film, like, there were some parts that were a little bit campy, and the CGI could have definitely been better, but there were definitely some parts of, like, legitimate dread and, like, fascination with the creature that was created in The Ritual. And I know that, you know, his hands were probably tied a little bit more, given the, you know, original source material. You know, you had to have a pinhead again. I get that. It would have been cool if David Bruckner kept some of that tension from The Ritual, or kept some of the mystery that we saw in that film. It was a lot more of an isolated situation. But then again, they could have rewritten Hellraiser and kept it in a much smaller location, too. They could have kept it at one of the characters' apartments. They could have kept it at the mansion. That there was no reason for them to go to these different places and to add all this exposition, again, just to get to another Cenobite kill. And all the Cenobite kills were the same! Oh, man. So anyway, I would give Hellraiser 2022 a rating of weird in a bad way. Please comment below and let me know what you thought of Hellraiser 2022 and if you think I should check out the original. Also, if you do like all things horror, mystery, and Eldritch, please consider subscribing. I'd love to have you, and I will see you in the next video.